believe it is time to move on.
Yes, those are the orders.
There was a sense of doom the last few shows because there seemed to be rumors around that the network wasn't picking it up.
We very strongly suspected we were going to be canceled almost immediately after we started the third season.
Always it is the brave ones who die.
There was a feeling throughout the entire organization that we were just playing out the string, that we were lame ducks, and that when the year was over, that would be it.
Towards the end of the season, the morale was pretty low, you know, because that's where it was going.
And some of the episodes actually reflected that. I think there was a significant drop-off in quality of the shows as we progressed deeper into the third season. But we didn't learn that we were being canceled until Gene Roddenberry called us.
I guess we weren't sufficiently entertaining.
I think we stopped shooting sometime in February or March, and then, or perhaps even April, but it was about 2 months later that Gene called us and said that we had been canceled, and that it was so interesting because he said, hope we can work together again sometime. Now, that was probably the most prophetic comment anybody could have made, and yet it was made, you know, almost idly, you know, in a kind of a flip way. Certainly, he didn't believe that we were coming back, nor did anybody else.
I don't agree with you, Mr. Spock.
Involved with Star Trek.
Beauty survives.
I fell in battle, pierced to the heart. And did not die.
It's a different time now. When Star Trek was in the prime time, there wasn't that much interest in science fiction. Science fiction supposedly was almost death, you know, to go in with it. Now, when the show went off the air and then it went into syndication, it, like at 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock, the kids got onto it and it became a smash hit.
I am not Herbert.
He's not Herbert. We reach.
And I suppose from that point on, Network probably did more promotion on it. And people, a lot of the scientific age I just started to come through.
Their will to survive is great.
It was much more interested. Asimov became a name, you know, that was Bradbury, you know. All of these guys now started to get very, quite famous. And there seemed to be much more of an acceptance for it.
What's your next move?
Star Trek was at its worst undoubtedly those years before we made the first movie because there were so many incarnations that it was going through. First it was to be a television show, and then it was to be a movie of the week, and then it was to be a movie, and then it was to be a television show again.
Oh, how faceless and fickle.
Make up your minds.
So it was the studio's indecision about which way to go with it and how to handle it. And then when Gene had written one, and the studio person who was the head of the studio at the time had said no, it wasn't going to happen. And at a meeting in New York, the owner of Paramount had said, well, don't we have something after Star Wars came out? Don't we have something like that? And they said, yeah, it's called Star Trek. He said, well, let's drag it back out again.
Oh, that's just lovely.
But not totally unexpected.
And those are times that are down. But Gene, you know, he didn't let those things bother him. Again, he was a very, very incredible optimist. And he wanted to keep busy.
Busy, busy, busy,
busy, busy, busy, busy, busy, busy.
I can quote him, the emotional and physical cost is quite high. It is the artist's calculated risk, like the candle that will burn for just so long. You can force it to burn brighter, but it will also burn faster. You pay for it. Still, I'd rather do that than flicker dimly in a corner.